Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 5th October 2018. The articles we'll be covering in detail are these 8. Now, let's discuss them. The first article is from the topic of agriculture of paper 3, Fields of Concern on MSP for Kharif Crop. In the 2018 budget, the Government of India has announced a 1.5 time hike in MSP, and this 1.5 time hike in MSP is towards its aim of achieving doubling farmers' income by 2022. So this article, it talks upon this MSP issue. Within months of announcing generous hike in minimum support price, which was only for kharif crop during the budget, now the government has come forward and announced another hike for rabi crops. So now the hike is both for kharif crops as well as rabi crops. So we have to know what is a kharif and what is rabi. So rabi crops here, they are generally planted in the months of November and it is harvested around April. The major crops which come under this rabi category are wheat, barley, chickpea, gram, etc. And what constitutes kharif crop? So the kharif crops are generally sown in rainy season. So the rainy season in India, it occurs generally in the month of June, July, and it goes on till September. So the major crops coming under this kharif category are paddy, that is rice, maize, soya bean, groundnut, cotton, etc. So on comparing the price hike of kharif and rabi crop, let's take two crops to do comparison. So the first crop let's consider is ragi, which is actually a kharif crop. So the MSP of this ragi has seen a hike of about 50%. However, the rabi crop, say safflower, the government has increased its MSP only by about 20.6%. However, both kharif and rabi crops both have seen a considerable hike in the MSP recently. So, via this hike of the MSP of kharif and rabi crop, the government has delivered its promise to the farmers that it will give at least 150% above their price of cost of production. So, it has also stated that by increasing the MSP, it will definitely increase their income, that is doubling their income over a period of time. However, how far this increase in MSP prices will get manifested in the farmers' income level is a big question mark. For example, let's talk about the current agrarian crisis that is happening in multiple states in our country. So recently, thousands of angry farmers, they descended in the roads of New Delhi, and the police had to use tear gas and even cannons to stop them. So that is the level of agrarian distress experienced by the farmers present in our country. So what is the solution for addressing this extensive farmer crisis prevailing now? So number one is the rise in the cost of inputs. So just merely increasing of MSP alone is not sufficient to meet this farmer distress. The rise of cost of inputs, especially such as fertilizers, which is essential for healthy growth of plants, and diesel, which is used to run the water pumps, is very much essential for practicing healthy agriculture in our country. So these two issues, that is the inputs deadlock, must be addressed by the government. And the second issue is there are multiple stress points in the path of Indian agriculture. For example, at the ground level, there are procurement issues. Other than a couple of important crops like paddy and wheat, the MSP formula, it doesn't actually work for many other crops. Only wheat and rice, they get extensive importance, and the other crops are completely neglected via the present MSP formula. And the third dimension we have to look upon here is the trade war, especially in the context of ongoing US-China trade war. For example, take a crop like cotton. So the market prices of cotton is currently increasing close to the MSP. But this increase is only due to the export demand rise due to the trade war between US and China. So when the trade war between US and China finally end, the price rise of cotton will also stop. So this is a concern which needs to be addressed taking into long-term perspective. So in order to address these issues, a robust mechanism is necessary. So this mechanism must help the farmers to get the announced MSP via price deficiency payment system and also via private procurement plan in order to increase the efficiency of delivery to the farmers. So a complete reboot of Indian agricultural sector is necessary, especially to address the restrictive trading policies and extensive government interference in order to enhance the productivity of the farmers. The second issue we'll be seeing today is Manifesto of Dissent. So this article, it touches upon society topic as well as ethics of paper 4. So many important dimensions talked upon in this article can also be used for essay writing. So our Supreme Court of India's constitutional bench, it has delivered more than 5 important judgments in past 1 month. And one of the important dimensions in these judgments is the dissent. For example, in the adultery judgment, Justice Hindu Malhotra, she manifested a dissent. And in Aadhaar case, Justice Chandrachud, he gave a dissenting opinion in comparison to the other 4 judges. So here, the dissent today is one of the most critical acts of democracy. In a democracy, every person has the right to speech as provided in our fundamental rights. So dissent is an essential part of this right to speech ensured to the citizens of our country. So here the author says that dissent as a concept and as an activity must be differentiated from the concept of radicalism. So what is radicalism? So radicalism is mostly totalitarian, while dissent is pluralistic. So in any pluralistic society like India, where there is diversity existing, for example, so in any diverse country like India, where there are multiple languages, multiple castes, multiple religions, etc. existing, dissent becomes very important part of the fundamental right of a person. And the author also says that dissent is one way among many ways for stating the truth. So take into consideration example of Marxism as a form of radicalism. So Marxism always deals with dualism and binaries. So according to Marx, there are only 2 types of people. One is proletariat, that is the have-nots, and the bourgeois, that is the haves. So there is always discrimination of the have-nots by the haves, which will finally result in a revolution, which will result in the establishment of communist society according to Marx. According to the author, this Marxism has become a very important ideology because of a variety of dissenting imaginations and the opinions surrounding Marxism. So dissent is again a very important form of right of every person. So dissent, it seeks to articulate differences, it celebrates plurality, and it attains the sense of diversity, especially in a democratic country. So according to the author also adds that a dissenter, unlike an ideologist or a radical, he claims the whole truth. Any dissenter is considered as a custodian, a trustee of truth, which are being lost in the mainstream of majority debate. So, according to the author, the opinion of the dissenter is very much important in order to show the truth to the society. So, according to the author, the dissenter is also considered as a custodian of the views of the minority people, especially in a majority-dominated ideas. So, dissenter has to challenge the hegemonic ideas without demanding such exclusivity for his own or knowledge system. He gives an example of the concept of satyagrahi here. Oh, the satyagrahi in this sense, he epitomizes the concept of dissent and the dissent of life. Take into consideration Mahatma Gandhi. So Mahatma Gandhi, in the experiments of truth, he represented a dissenting idea. So here the dissenting idea is the concept of non-violence and ahimsa. So here the dissenter lives out of an idea, and his protest is always towards non-violence. And hence, via this article, the author emphasizes the importance of dissent, especially in a democratic country, and how dissent is very important to maintain the transformative nature of Indian constitution with the evolution of the society. The third article we'll be seeing today is The Next Steps at GIR. So for past couple of days, the newspaper had the article about the increasing deaths in number of tigers at Gir Wildlife Sanctuary in Gujarat. So 23 lions have died in past few weeks, eastern parts of Gujarat's Gir Sanctuary. So in this domain, we have to note down a judgment given by Supreme Court in the year 2013. According to view of the Supreme Court, some of the lions had to be relocated from Gujarat to the Kuno Sanctuary of Madhya Pradesh in order to protect the genetic diversity of lions existing in India. But however, because of the state politics, this relocation did not happen. According to the state of Gujarat, lions at Gir are their personal pride and they denied to relocate the lion to the state of Madhya Pradesh. So this view of Supreme Court in the year 2013 was not implemented. And again, couple of days back, Supreme Court also intervened in the same issue, stating that the death of so many lions is a serious matter, and it asked the central government to look into this issue seriously with utmost importance. So here comes the importance of the concept of wildlife conservation. So the concept of wildlife conservation must be looked upon from two dimensions. So first dimension is maintaining the ecological process. And the second is reducing the threats to endangered species. If one maintains the ecological process, one must not interfere in the process and pave way for the process of natural selection to work and take its toll. However, in order to reduce the threats to endangered species, it becomes important that human intervention is necessary in order to save the species. So, if we see this concept from maintaining the ecological process perspective, it is given that one must not treat the wild animals for disease as it can go against the process of natural selection. So, according to this, treating wild animals is not conducive to the natural process of life and death, and it ultimately compromises the immunity. Because of the human intervention, the immunity of the ecological system can be compromised, which may lead to further complication. So, from this perspective, human interference must be avoided and natural selection must take its own way. So, a classic example of this is the case of Machli, a tigress from Ranthambore Sanctuary in Rajasthan. So, she has been regarded as the world's most photographed tigers, as she lived for 20 years until her death in 2016. So, now the process of decoding the DNA of this Machli tiger is also going on. So, it is considered that because she was treated medically and often fed artificially, her life scale got reduced to 20 years, which is comparatively less when compared to the amount of lifespan she would have had if she has left with the nature. So, taking into consideration of this perspective, wildlife conservation must balance both of these perspectives evenly in order to protect the highly endangered species, especially like Indian tigers. And one of the options to save this tiger's crisis existing currently is to shift the tigers from the Gir Sanctuary to Bhadra Wildlife Sanctuary in the same state of Gujarat. So, this Gir Natural and Park and Wildlife Sanctuary is located here and Bhadra is here. Both of the places, they are in the state of Gujarat, and the transportation is also very much feasible. And finally, there is no getting around the fact that geographically separate population of Asiatic tigers need to be created. This is very much essential in order to avoid the epidemic situation which occurred recently in Africa, which may wash away a huge amount of genetic species from existence. So, in order to provide a good track record for lion conservation, a long-term strategy is very much imperative. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is, Centre announces 2.5 rupees cut in fuel prices. It also urges states to match it. So, we all know that the prices of fuels has crossed the 90 rupees mark in several states, and this is a very high state of concern, as without fuel, the natural day-to-day activities cannot happen in this current modern world. So, in order to rescue the people from this crisis, the government has decided to implement a cumulative cut of Rs 2.5 per litre on the fuel prices, with Centre absorbing 1.5 rupees of this, and the oil marketing companies, they absorb 1 rupee of the cut. And this announcement has come from the Union Finance Ministry on Thursday. The Union Finance Ministry has also urged the states to match the 2.5 rupees cut with equivalent cut in the respective VAT rates of the fuel. So this VAT, which is value added tax. So this value added tax under the current GST regime, it's under the responsibility of the state. So only the individual states can change the respective VATs. So this VAT comes under the indirect tax regime. So when you buy some stuff, the shopkeeper is responsible for paying the tax, but he collects the tax indirectly from you. So value added tax is such an indirect tax, and only state government can change the tax in the current setup. The finance ministry also stated the two main factors for this rise in the fuel prices. One is the Brent oil has crossed $83 a barrel, the highest has been in last 4 years. This is one of the important reasons for increase in fuel prices in our country. We all know that India imports most of its oil requirements from other countries. So an increase in Brent oil price across the globe will definitely have its effect on Indian oil prices. The second is the US interest rates have been raised to 3.2%, which is the highest ever interest rate it has seen in the recent times. So this has also influenced the fuel prices in our country. So with this cut in the fuel prices, more than 10 states in our country will see the reduction in the fuel prices. If the states also reduce their VAT, then the fuel prices may come down even further. The fifth article we'll be seeing today is no trial in severe debt cases. So a sample study was conducted by Rashtriya Garima Abhiyan, which is an NGO partnering with the Union Ministry of Social Justice. So it conducted a census for manual scavenging, which covered almost 11 states. The survey noted 97 deaths and 51 incidences of injury due to manual scavenging in this 11 states. So according to this sample survey, the first information report, that is the FIR, filed for the deaths in sewer and septic tank cleaning cases from 1992 stands at only 35%. And none from this 37% led to trial or prosecution of any sort. So this shows the poor implementation of law in our country. And only 31% of the affected families, they received the cash compensation as promised, while none of them received rehabilitation or any other alternative laws which has been entitled to them according to the Manual Scavengers and the Rehabilitation Act of 2013. The NGO also added that there have been 302 deaths and 140 incidences in these states, which however also adds that the actual number of deaths and incidences will be multifold higher than what is empirically stated. So India has established a separate commission for this, for the help of manual scavengers, which is called the Safai Karamcharis Finance and Development Cooperation. So this cooperation is established under the Ministry of Social Justice. So the ministry will also conduct 200 camps across the country for the sanitation workers to appraise them and also to provide other sources of employment for them as per the provisions of this Manual Scavengers Act 2013. So the implementation of this act is very much necessary in order to safeguard the provisions and rights entitled to the manual scavengers in our country. So the sixth article we'll be seeing today is with respect to the international relations, eyes on India. So we all know the whole region of Asia is in state of flux. Take into consideration the actions of China. So we all know about the ongoing China's Belt and Road Initiative. So this Belt and Road Initiative of China is aimed to reshape the region's geography. We are building many infrastructure projects with road and railway connectivity. So the project connects Asia to Eurasia via new ports in the Indian Ocean region. This will definitely increase the influence of China in the Indian Ocean region, and also the small countries in the Indian Ocean region will be coming under the influence of China. So we all know about the withdrawal of US from Trans-Pacific Partnership. Because of the withdrawal of US from this partnership, now Japan has to take the leadership role, which we don't know if Japan is prepared for. And Tokyo is also now contemplating about the constitutional revisions that would enable it to play more military role. So far in the past few decades, Japan has refrained from participating in many military role in the global scenario. Now it has brought in a constitutional amendment to increase the military role played by it in the global era. So these cases, it shows the unfolding events and the series of risks present in the region of Asia. So the countries of Japan, Korea, Taiwan and Australia, they all have their own strategies to diversify their economic interests via economic interdependence in the region of Asia. So in order to diversify their interests, they definitely need the support of Southeast Asia and mainly India. So practically, it is a very big positive situation for India, and it may even result in accelerated India's economic growth. So India must make use of the situation with valid efforts by Indian government. The seventh issue we'll be seeing today is ethics panel discusses checks and balances. So the parliamentarians are deliberating on having checks and balances while making their personal information public. So this debate of whether putting the information regarding the parliamentarians' personal details in public domain has been in the news for past couple of years. So the Rajya Sabha's Parliamentary Committee on Ethics, it discussed this issue recently. So we have to know what is a parliamentary committee on ethics. So this parliamentary committee on ethics is present both in Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha. So in Rajya Sabha, it was constituted way back in 1997 and it has 10 members. And in Lok Sabha, it was constructed only recently and it has 15 members. So the 15 members in Lok Sabha and the 10 members in Rajya Sabha, they discuss about the ethical conduct of various members of the parliament. They also can discuss about various ethical issues if they are specifically asked to discuss upon. And this is once among such issue. So here the debate is, allowing the information of the parliamentarians in public domain, it could be accessed by anyone through Right to Information Act. So this may be an infringement of right to privacy of the parliamentarians according to them. So according to view of parliamentarians, the rule 279, it stands contradictory to Right to Information Act. So this is because the information can be divulged only through certain condition according to the rule 293 of the rules of the parliament. However, if the information is put into public domain, you cannot have any condition according to Right to Information Act. So some members have felt that availability of information should be made conditional and the present rule must be strengthened to protect their privacy. The last issue we'll be seeing today is the road to deportation. So the issue of Rohingyas has been in news for past couple of years, and this road of deportation, it talks about the recent deportation of 7 Rohingya refugees from India back to their own state of Myanmar. So who are Rohingyas? So Rohingyas, they constitute a closed ethnic group mostly consisting of Muslims. They are originally from Rakhine province of Western Myanmar. The issue here is the state of Myanmar has not given them full citizenship and they are only classified as resident foreigners or associated citizens. They usually speak Bengali dialect but they are not Burmese. So these Rohingya refugees, they left Myanmar in large number, especially it began in the year 2012 and the first wave it continued and several people started to leave the state of Myanmar facing prosecution there. Around almost 5 lakh Rohingya refugees have taken shelter only in the country of Saudi Arabia since 2012. So how many refugees are there in India? So according to Home Ministry, about 40,000 Rohingya refugees are presently in the state of India, and among which more than 5,000 are present in the state of Jammu Kashmir. There are almost 12 Rohingya rehabilitation detention camps only in the state of Assam. As of 2017, the Border Security Force, that is BSF, it apprehended almost 87 Rohingyas along the Bangladesh border, and 76 of them were sent back to the state of Bangladesh. So what is the process of deportation of this Rohingyas? So Rohingyas, as in they do not have any special deportation process, they come under normal process of deportation, which is either under Passport Act of 1920 or under the Foreigners Act of 1946. The powers to identify Rohingya and to deport them, it comes under the delegation of the state governments or the union territories. If a person is found out by the state police forces that he has been staying in the country without proper legal documents, then he can be taken to the court. The court, after listening the views of both the police and the foreigner, will deliver the judgment, and they may be imprisoned from up to 3 months to 8 years according to the current provisions. So the next question is there any advisory given by Union Home Ministry specific to the case of Rohingyas? On August 2017, the ministry specially gave a notification stating that infiltration from Rakhine state of Myanmar is very much threat to Indian territory, India's security. So this Rohingya people are seen as a burden to the limited resources available in India, and there is also potential rise of terrorism because of the inflow of excess refugees according to the notice of the Indian Home Ministry. So let's come to this issue of deportation of the 7 Rohingyas yesterday. Was the deportation of the 7 Rohingyas on Thursday the first instance? So while deportation of foreigners staying illegally in India has occurred several times, but this is the first time Myanmar has officially accepted these 7 Rohingyas and issued them with identity certificate 2 months ago. So this process of deportation can be replicated for other 40,000 Rohingya refugees who are presently living in our country. So a peaceful solution to this Rohingya crisis is very much essential in order to avoid a huge humanitarian crisis and also for ensuring a global peace. Thank you.